Well, future geologists, this is our last chapter that we're going to cover this semester, and it is on groundwater. Groundwater is actually the water that is found in the pores of soil and sediment and in fractures of bedrock as well. The important thing about groundwater, it is the largest reservoir of usable fresh water. Most of our fresh water is locked up in glaciers and ice sheets. Groundwater then is usable in the sense that it is accessible, whereas ice is not, and it makes up 30% of fresh water. You may think that we have a lot of water in our lakes and river systems. However, you can see that that's only 4%. The importance of groundwater is that it erodes things. For instance, it dissolves carbonate rocks such as limestone to form caves and sinkholes. And it also equalizes stream flow. And I can show you that in a figure here. Here is groundwater that has dissolved the carbonate rock and created a cavern. I'll show you the examples of how groundwater equalizes a flow of rivers and streams in a few slides down. 23% of the water that we use in the United States comes from groundwater. Primary users are farmers who irrigate the land. So if we look at this pie diagram here, we use water in this country, 77% we use surface water, 23% groundwater. Now that 23% of the groundwater, most of it is being used for irrigation, some for public supply, and then there's some miscellaneous uses as well. Here's how we utilize our water in gallons per day. So showers and baths, you can see toilets, not very efficient. Leaking faucets waste a lot of water. Dishwashers, on the other hand, are quite efficient. I want to look down underground and see what's going on and outline some various zones that we refer to when we talk of groundwater. First of all, the zone of soil moisture is an area where water is held due to electrical attraction between the molecules onto the soil particles. It's very close to the surface. This water is used by plants, and a lot of it evaporates back to the atmosphere. Some water in the zone of soil moisture is not held to the soil particles and will percolate further down. The phreatic zone, or the zone of saturation, is an area underground where 100% of the pore spaces is filled with water. The very top of the zone of saturation we'll call the water table. Sitting right on top of the water table is the capillary fringe. Now, the unsaturated zone is the area above the zone of saturation, and there's water in some of the pore spaces, but air in others. And so it's not completely saturated, and hence the unsaturated zone. Technically, the capillary fringe, as well as the zone of soil moisture, is part of the unsaturated zone. This figure clearly outlines these zones underground. So we have our soil moisture, unsaturated zone, capillary fringe, the water table, which is the dashed blue line. Below that is the zone of saturation where 100% of the pore space is filled with water. If we look down here in this diagram, we have two different water tables they're showing here. The normal water table sits at this depth. During a drought, the water table actually can change its elevation, in this case, drop down. If we look over at this well that was drilled, this well will produce water as long as it's a normal season. However, you can see that during a drought, the water table actually is below the bottom of your well, so you would not be able to use this well to extract water. So the water table is variable. The depth is variable, and it varies from season to season and year to year. Overall, we can say that the water table shape mimics the topography of the land. And generally, we are not able to view the water table unless it happens to pop out at the Earth's surface, such as when a spring comes to the Earth's surface. That is actually the water table hitting the Earth's surface. This is a map of Missouri, and all the blue dots are areas where they monitor the depth to the water table. You can see in this figure here, and we're in the year 2006, 2007, this y-axis is the depth to the water table, and this is time or the month. So you can see that the depth of the water table varies during the dry season and obviously fluctuates from year to year and season to season. So this steady drop here in water level from May to November is a result of discharge from the aquifer to springs and streams, and it was not being replaced by recharge because it was not raining, so it was a period of drought. So as a geologist, you can determine the depth to the water table by taking a drill rig and going out and drilling holes and seeing where you hit the zone of saturation. This first map here are the locations of the wells that were drilled, and this is feet below the surface. I take that back. These elevations are feet above sea level, which is zero elevation. All right, and these are the depths to the water table, so it's above sea level. So we have plotted these elevations. Now we can contour, as we've done previously. So at a depth of water table depth of 151, and here we have 141, we could draw a contour of 150 feet here and go by tens, 140, 30, 20, and so forth. So now we have the water table contoured. After that, we can draw these solid blue lines on that show the direction of flow of the groundwater. And how this is done is it does not matter where you draw the flow line as long as when it crosses a contour line, they cross at right angles. So it shows that the groundwater is flowing from the top of the map toward the bottom of the map. And this type of map would come in handy if you had a contamination issue of groundwater. If you knew that groundwater was flowing in this direction and there was a contaminant in the groundwater moving along with the groundwater, then you would have an idea of the general direction that that contaminant was flowing. Earlier, I mentioned that groundwater equalizes stream flow. So here's my discussion on that. Some streams are gaining water from groundwater. Some streams actually are losing their water into the groundwater system. And then we can have a combination of gaining and losing streams. So let's take a quick look at this. Once again, the solid blue area is the zone of saturation. The solid blue lines are the direction that the groundwater is flowing. So since the groundwater is flowing into the stream, we call the stream a gaining stream. It is gaining water. The reason that these lines curve up against gravity is because groundwater will seek areas of low pressure, and that's why they curve near the surface. Here we have a losing stream. So this stream is depositing water or draining into the groundwater system. And in this case, we call it connected because the water table is connected to the stream. Here it's disconnected. The stream is not in contact with the water table. And so the water is actually percolating down and replenishing or recharging the aquifer. A couple of important factors when studying groundwater are porosity and permeability of materials. The porosity of a sediment or rock is the percentage of pore space in the sediment or rock. The percentage of pore space depends on the size and shape of the grains, how well they are sorted, and how tightly they are packed. So poorly sorted sediment will actually have a lower porosity because smaller grains will fill in that pore space rather than water being able to fill that in, and that decreases its porosity. Here is a porosity demonstration where we have a beaker of sediment and then a beaker of water, each at 1,000 milliliters. If you pour in the water until it is all the pore spaces are filled, that required 500 milliliters of water. And since 500 milliliters is half of 1,000, we know that the porosity of the sediment is 50%. I'm going to stop with video one here for chapter 17 and discuss permeability in video two.